Hi, welcome back. In this video, we're looking at Thirstlands by Nick Wood. I've been looking at a lot of environmental stories, particularly lately, and this is kind of the final one in the batch I've been looking at for this kind of set of videos, if you want to think of it that way. I don't have any notes at the top. It's from the collection Sunvault, Stories of Solarpunk and Eco-Speculation. And with all that said, let's go ahead and hop into our passage for this story. This is a hard place to be, but all I know right now is that this is where I want to die. This is where I want to lay down my bones, just like the elephants. Why? I have no bloody idea. Maybe it's to do with the light on the hills, or perhaps just the bit and smell of an ant. The thoughts circled my brain. Trapped in private, no place to go. Still, as I walked the path home, my steps felt somehow lighter, looser, but never quite tension-free. So, Thirstlands by Nick Wood is set in a water-scarce future Zambia. In addition to hints at climate disaster, large portions of water are used and hoarded by private companies for various uses. As you can guess from the title, folks are thirsty because water is scarce, right? Graham Mason, kind of our main character, went out to film Victoria Falls, or in the story there it has the original name, translated to Smoke That Thunders, if I remember correctly, in the hope that rain would boost the water supply. However, no rain appeared. Graham planned to film the rain through implants in his head, and in addition to filming via his eyes, he's also able to browse blogs and worryingly have his boss monitor his actions throughout the workday and beyond with these implants. After failing to secure the footage, he heads back home to Lizette, his partner of two or more decades. Lizette and Graham have slowly been drifting apart over various issues, among them the stress over securing water and children. And Lizette reveals to Graham that she shared their secret water supply, an underground well, with some of the local community in order to fight back against the number of children and others dying of thirst. While Graham is initially horrified that she would reveal this, and is fearful that it will make them a target, he eventually decides to help after, one, meeting with a hydrologist for one of the companies who spends her free time secretly working to provide water services for the communities, and two, reflecting on his own mortality and the fact that, while it may only be a short-term solution to the water issues, it's better to make a stand and fail than to give up. And so, our notes for the story are a little bit more scattered, right? There's some really interesting themes going on. Kind of the big theme, as I see it, is selfish protectionism and fear versus what we would call mutual aid and vulnerability, right? Is it worthwhile to risk helping others when it may make yourself vulnerable, or may, you know, not help yourself out in the long run? It might harm you, if you want to think of it that way. And we see this theme pop up in a couple places throughout the story. Like Lizette joining the co-op is an example of that mutual aid of helping out one's neighbors. The neighborhood choosing to put up power lines to steal power every day. After all, the story mentions that the companies have more than enough power through the solar panels, that they have an excess of it. And that it seems like it's low maintenance too. So it's literally them just choosing not to provide the power for cheaper. Water turning into a private good in the story, right? So water is being turned into that kind of selfish protectionism and fear. It mentions that the majority of water is used to produce biofuels for tanks elsewhere in the world, going back to, again, people putting up arms and being defensive when the water would obviously help people out better if they were able to drink water rather than use that water to make biofuel for tanks. We also get this image of an elephant graveyard early on in the story, where they're dying with some form of dignity side by side, or some type of communal death, it seems. And even though, obviously, you know, it's not great to die and lay down like that, the image of them dying side by side is especially important for this story, as far as mutual aid and vulnerability, because just like, you know, the main character, it may not be... it may only be a short-term issue, but it's better to kind of stand together, right? That seems to be what the story's getting at. And finally, there's a connection between the boss and man, the boss and the main character. It's direct through technology, but notice also that human-to-human connection throughout the story is missing, outside of Lizette and her co-op and her ability to meet with the hydrologist. So there's, again, it all ties back into this big theme of kind of what we call selfish protectionism versus kind of mutual aid, right? Are you focusing on yourself? Are you afraid of your neighbor, or are you helping out your neighbor? And so, one of the big questions of the story is what inspires Graham to actually change his mind at the end of the story? Why does he eventually agree to help? As always, cite the text and any other sources to support your answer. And thank you for watching. I'll see you in the next video.